In this video, we'll be focusing on the implementation of authentication and authorization features within a Blazor web application. Our first task involves the development of a user-friendly login page, allowing users to authenticate themselves by entering their credentials. Additionally, we'll delve into the establishment of permissions based on user roles. This ensures that users can only access components and features for which they have been explicitly granted the permission. So let's delve into the details of this implementation. To begin, we'll incorporate the necessary services in the program.cs class of our new Blazor web app project. I'm utilizing the addAuthentication method to register the essential services required for authentication. For the authentication mechanism, we'll be using cookie authentication by assigning cookie authentication defaults dot authentication scheme as the default scheme. Subsequently, I'll use the addCookie method to configure various options, such as assigning a custom name to the cookie for easier identification. Additionally, we'll designate the login path, anticipating the creation of a login page with this specified URL. In consideration of user experience, I typically set a max age for the cookie to facilitate automatic logout after a specific duration. Furthermore, an access denied page is being assigned to address scenarios where user attempt to access unauthorized pages, leading to the creation of an error display page. Moving forward, we'll integrate middlewares for both authentication and authorization. I'm incorporating the authorization service through the use of the addAuthorization method. Lastly, a crucial service is introduced using the addCascading authentication state, responsible for efficiently passing the authentication state throughout the application. I have just incorporated database integration to our application, enabling the retrieval of a user account details from the SQL Server database. As we have previously covered the details of the database integration in our earlier videos, I won't delve into extensive explanations here. For those who are interested in the code, it is available on our Patreon page, and you can find the link in the video description. Within the app settings, I have specified the connection string and introduced an entity named user account. The data folder houses the DB contacts class. Let me show you a quick look at the database in my SQL Management Studio. If you look into the user account table, you'll observe two users, each assigned different roles, administrator and user. Moving on, we'll proceed to develop the login page. In the Pages folder, I'm creating a new folder called Account to organize pages related to authentication and authorization. Our first task is to add a new register component called Login in this specified folder. Before delving into the development of the login page, we'll establish a view model to manage user input. Inside the newly created view models folder, I'm creating a class named Login View Model. This class will incorporate two properties, username and password. To enhance user input validation, I'll include the required attribute for both the properties, along with custom error messages. Within the login page, we'll declare the login view model object and utilize the supply parameter from form attribute, as we'll be receiving the object property values from an edit form. Next, let me provide the design for entering the credentials. To handle the form submission, we'll create a method named authenticate. The form includes input text, elements for both username and password, accompanied by validation messages for enhanced user guidance. Additionally, a string variable for error messages will be declared, and the error message will be displayed just above the login button. To facilitate user authentication, we require the HTTP context object, which can be obtained as a cascading parameter. Let's proceed with implementing the authenticate method. To access the user account details from the database, we'll inject the DB context into the component. Initially, we fetch the user account by filtering with the username provided in the input text. Subsequently, we check if the user account object is null, indicating the absence of a user account with the provided username. We also verify if the provided password matches. In case of any invalid input, we display an error message and exit the method. If both conditions are met, we proceed to create a list of claims. The first claim holds the username, while the second one holds the user role. Following this, a claims identity object is generated with the claims as the first parameter and the authentication scheme used previously as the second parameter. We then create a claims principle using the identity object. Finally, the signin async method is utilized to sign in the principle, completing the user authentication process. Upon successful authentication, we can redirect the user back to the home page. To achieve this, we'll inject the navigation manager and utilize the navigateTo method for redirection. Additionally, let's configure the page URL to align with the one assigned as the login path in the program.cs class, ensuring consistency in navigation. Moving forward, let's create the access denied page. Within the accounts folder, I'm adding a razor component named access denied. To maintain consistency, I'll use the same URL as specified in the dependency service options. The design of this page will be straightforward, displaying a message such as, "You don't have permission to access this page." Next, we'll create the logout page, which will be displayed when a user clicks the logout button. First, let's assign the page URL. On this page, we'll present a simple message confirming successful logout. In the code section, we obtain the HTTP context object through cascading parameters. Moving on, we override the onInitialized async method and make it asynchronous. Within this method, we check if the user is authenticated. If yes, we proceed to sign out the user using the signout async method. To ensure components are refreshed, we use the navigation manager to reload the page. Navigating the user to the same page with the force load parameter enabled. Now, to implement different behaviors in the application based on the authentication status, let's start by making changes to the main layout. Within the main layout, we'll incorporate the authorize view to conditionally display login and logout buttons. To simplify the code, we'll remove the namespace from the tag and import it. Considering the need for this namespace in other pages as well, we'll move it to imports.razor, enabling its use in any components. For users who are not authorized, we'll display a login button. On the other hand, for authorized users, we can present the logout button. In the nav menu component as well, we'll incorporate the authorized view and authorized tags. Additionally, roles will be assigned for the authorized view to control access. We'll move the counter page nav link inside the authorized tag so that it is accessible only to the users with the roles administrator or user. Subsequently, another authorized view is included, specifying only the administrator role. The weather page nav link will be moved within this tag, ensuring that the weather page can only be accessed by users with administrator role. Moving on to the home page, you'll notice that no render modes are assigned and it currently utilizes static render mode. For a more in-depth understanding of render modes, you can refer to the Blazor web app video, part of the Blazor tutorial playlist. In the home page, our focus is on demonstrating how authorize view works with a static page. We'll place a welcoming message at the top and beneath that, display the login or logout option based on the authentication status. Proceeding to the counter page, you'll observe that it is using interactive server render mode. Our goal here is to display a button exclusively for authenticated users. We'll implement an onClick method named displayGreetingAlert. The purpose of this method is to showcase a greeting message along with the username of the authenticated user. To fetch the username from code, we need the authentication state object, which can be retrieved from cascading parameters. The object is of type task of authentication state, and we can obtain the authentication state by awaiting it. Now, we can create the message to be displayed by concatenating the username from authentication state to the message. To display an alert, we'll inject IJS runtime and leverage invoke void async method to ensure proper functionality of the implemented features. An important change needs to be made in the routes.razor component. Instead of using route view, we should utilize authorize route view for the desired functionality. This adjustment is crucial for the proper functioning of the authentication and authorization features in the application. While our project implementation remains incomplete, a minor issue persists within our application that needs attention. Let's proceed to run the project and test all functionalities. While testing, I'll demonstrate the issue and provide a resolution to address it. On the home page, you'll notice the welcome message along with the two login buttons. Let's attempt to login using an admin account. Upon successful login, the menu options become visible, and the logout button replaces the login button on the home page. Moving to the counter page, clicking the greeting button triggers an alert displaying the username. Furthermore, access to the weather page is granted. All functionalities appear to be functioning correctly. Clicking on the logout button appropriately displays the logout message. Now, let's proceed to login again with the other user account. You'll observe that the weather option is no longer visible in the menu. On the counter page, the greeting message now correctly displays the new username. Let's delve into the developer options to inspect the authorization cookie. In the cookie section of the application tab, you can find the cookie labeled auth token with its expiration period. As a demonstration, if I delete the cookie, you'll observe that I'm automatically logged out from the application. Now let me demonstrate the issue. I'll sign in with the user account, and you'll notice that the weather option is not available in the menu. However, if I attempt to access it by entering the URL manually in the address bar, you can see that I'm able to bypass the intended authorization checks. Now, after completely logging out, I'll attempt to manually enter the URL. Surprisingly, I can access the counter page and interact with its components without proper authentication. Furthermore, the weather page is also accessible for an unauthenticated user, presenting a security loophole. Let's explore how we can address and resolve this vulnerability. To enforce restrictions, we need to implement them within the component itself. Let's begin with the weather component. We can introduce an attribute named authorize for the weather component. Similar to authorize view, we can specify roles within this attribute. For this demonstration, I'm assigning the administrator role to restrict access. Now, let's implement the same authorization restrictions in the counter page. In this case, we'll allow access for both administrator and user roles. Let's proceed to test these changes. I'm attempting to access the pages without signing in with any users. You'll notice an automatic redirection to the login page. Now, if we try accessing the weather page directly via its URL, we once again find ourselves redirected to the login page, reinforcing the authentication requirement. Let's proceed to login with a user account. This user, however, is granted access only to the counter page. Let's attempt to access the weather page, and there comes the access denied page, which we designed. Here, the user is authenticated, but don't have permission to access this page. This concludes our discussion for now. For a more in-depth understanding of Blazor, make sure to explore our comprehensive Blazor tutorial playlist. If you found this video helpful, remember to show your support by liking, sharing, and subscribing to our channel. Thank you.